Hey guys, welcome to the Swallow Motor Live Show presented by OGIO Powersports and FMF Racing. Today I'm joined again by the king of supercross and my landlord, Jeremy McGrath. So buddy, thanks for coming up today to sit in on the show again.
Yeah, it's nice to be here. It's been a little while since the last time I was actually with you here in the studio, so
yeah,
it's good to be here.
Well, we did that fun ARMA Instagram thing a couple weeks ago.
Oh, yeah.
From Salt Lake City, but I think the last time we filmed the show together, we were doing tequila shots.
Yeah, in Whistler.
Yeah.
Yeah, and that was a great time, by the way.
Yeah.
We probably should do that again soon.
Yeah, I'm so bummed because I just got the email from my buddies that Canada extended the border closure.
Oh, I heard, yeah, Whistler's now going to be closed for like the whole season, right?
Yeah, so.
Sucks.
I don't know, they canceled Crankworks, and I already had plane tickets and a bike rental reserve, so. Kind of bummed out about that.
The good thing is it was not going anywhere. You can get there the next year.
Yeah, that's true. Yeah. That's true. So, what was it like for you sitting back and watching the Supercross Marathon in Salt Lake? Was it like...
Look, we were all excited to get back to watching some racing, right?
Yeah.
I was thinking about actually going to check out a race or two, even though it was kind of limited on people and all that stuff. But then I saw how they did the COVID test and I was a little freaked out about that. So I was like, I think I'll stay home and watch it from here. But needless to say, it was exciting. I thought the very first Salt Lake race that they came with was a dry, dusty, kind of like, I was like, oh no, this is gonna be a shit show.
It's gonna be a long seven races.
But I thought Dirtworks did a good job. They rebounded hard from that. I know that first race was really hot.
Mm-hmm.
I think we all were treated to a nice series and nice ending of the year.
Yeah.
It was exciting to watch.
It was funny because a couple days ago it was the first Wednesday when we didn't have racing, and I was like, oh, what am I going to do with myself?
Well, I think we all certainly got spoiled, right? It's like, wow, we get two races a week for like a couple...
Three weeks
or whatever. That was pretty cool. So, again, circumstances were tough. I get all that. But, you know, I thought like once it got going, I'm pretty sure, and you could probably confirm, that the riders pretty much enjoyed that because they didn't have to fly anywhere. They didn't have to do anything. They weren't riding that much because they were racing 2 days a week.
Mm-hmm.
So like they kind of probably got in a good flow where they just felt like, I could race a couple times a week.
Yeah.
If it meant getting the series over sooner.
Yeah. There were a couple guys were talking about like, man, it would be nice, you know, next year's schedule to have a couple races where we race like a Wednesday and a Sunday or a Wednesday and a Saturday. Just to knock it out and get some time off.
However, that could also backfire because if you crash and you hurt yourself or whatever and you needed 5-6 days to heal, well then you'd be kind of screwed.
Absolutely.
So look, it works both ways. It was nice for us to be fans and be watching that, but also it was some tough points on the riders.
So the you know, obviously the 7 rounds in 3 weeks thing is something that will be talked about forever, like as an oddball, strange thing to be involved in. Looking back at your career, what was the strangest thing racing-wise like that for you? Was it the lights off in Vegas thing, or?
Yeah, I think certainly the Vegas, the night the lights went out in Vegas, and there was like, you know, all this conspiracy that like, you know, riders were trying to start a union and all this crazy stuff that night, and Roy Jansen was going nuts, dude.
Yeah.
I mean, that whole night was crazy in itself. It was one of those things that's like, all the riders agreed to not go out there. They brought in these shitty portable lights, and it was like, you know, all of a sudden you had a couple guys going, all right, yeah, we'll race, whatever. And then, you know, a couple of the big guys decided they were gonna race, and I don't know, I guess I'm just lucky I had a points lead and didn't have to worry about it. I know I took some flack for it, but at the same time, you know, I don't know. I just didn't think it was safe. That was definitely weird. I think one of the other weird ones was when we had the motocross race at Glen Helen. It was one moto format. That was part of that. That was, as ironic as it is, that was another day that me and Emig almost got into it. We got in a fight after the race, I think. At least I sh- remember shoving him on the ground and then the mechanics, whatever. But that was a crazy race. Jeff actually was going to win the race, I think, and then his bike broke at the end, mm-hmm. or it died on him, and I got third, 125 Honda at the time, mm-hmm. and he was winning, and I was like fourth probably, and then his bike stalled, and at the end I finished right either ahead of him or right behind him, wow. and then so it was on like right after that. So I was super pissed because on the start he just did one of his deals. And gosh,
that was every weekend thing though, wasn't it?
It was every weekend, but man, sometimes it wasn't as blatant as it was, and that one was just, I mean, I don't know, it was just like so uncalled for. He was better than me at the time, you know, outdoor mm-hmm. rider. I mean, he didn't have to do that.
Yeah.
But anyway, yeah, those were two of the weirdest, sort of circumstances when it comes to my racing career.
Yeah. Hey, so middle of last year, you did the inevitable knee replacement surgery, and I know that
I did.
It was a lot more painful than you thought it was going to be, right? So, what did they do for that? They just saw off the bottom of your femur and the top of your tibia and put fake bands on?
I mean, there was some misconception on my part, and probably a lot of people's part, that think like knee replacement stuff. I mean, I think the automatic thing you would think of is like chop the femur off, chop the tibia off, plug in, you know, a new knee, and the whole middle, you get a whole new knee, mm-hmm. right? Well, that's not how knee replacements work. And I was like, can't wait to get a new knee. I'm thinking I get this whole new awesome knee with ligaments and the whole thing. And so I was, I was out to lunch when I was thinking of exactly what was actually going to happen. Yeah. So come to find out, what they do is they take your femur, they sort of hex off the bone, mm-hmm. like a stop sign shape kind of, then they pin a piece of metal on it, mm-hmm. and then they take the lower leg, which is the tibia, and then they plateau, like the bone comes up like this, so they plateau it completely off, mm-hmm. get your leg straight, then they put metal on that, screw that in, and then they put a fake pad on there, like almost like a meniscus type pad. Yeah. And then they take your kneecap, flip it over, grind it out, and put metal in the backside of your knee. So then kneecap goes back in, metal is like your knee's working on metal mm-hmm. with a soft pad. And so that's kind of how, that's what a knee replacement is. Mm-hmm. I didn't think it was that. I thought it was like, hey, I'm getting a whole new knee. Really, they just metal plated all my own parts in there. So I didn't get a new ACL. So I'm still dealing with a little bit of a loose knee. But my problem was, not having an ACL for so long, my legs started to pronate out. So it was 11 degrees out, which basically was smashing everything on the outside of my knee. So mm-hmm. my meniscus was bone to bone. My meniscus pad was just destroyed. I had a ton of arthritis in the upper part of my knee. And I was just basically couldn't really run around with my kids anymore. And it was just hurting too bad every day. So I strictly did it for the pain part of it. The mm-hmm. only thing that kept me really going and was my bicycle. So I got a ton of bikes, mm-hmm. but that's now gotten a lot better. My whole upper leg was atrophied. I couldn't really flex this muscle for, I'd say probably 10 or 12 years. So it's half the size of my other leg. Thankfully now I'm able to build it back up, and my leg's growing up in size again. I'm getting stronger. I got a ton of,
range of motion.
Still not going to bend like completely up like that one.
Yeah.
But, I'm in no pain, feeling good.
No pain now,
but
it was gnarly at first, right?
It was like, I thought I was pretty tough. I'm like, you know what? I'm pretty tough. I'm going to breeze through this thing. It kicked my ass. Uh-huh. And I was surprised at how bad it hurt. I mean, I was hurting. Two weeks into it, I was still crying.
I know, I texted you, how's it going? You're like, I'm in a lot of pain. It's worse than I thought.
A lot of pain. Yeah. A lot of pain. I mean, crashed my dirt bike a lot. Been in a lot of pain before. Uh-huh. This was a whole nother level of pain.
Yeah.
And I didn't push it early. Like, it wasn't like, hey, I'm out there working out too hard, too soon, whatever. Mm-hmm. It was more like, it would just hurt. I mean, it's basically like having both broken legs at once, mm-hmm. and kneecaps or the whole thing. So, more pain than I than I suspected it would be. And I also, you know, 3 months into it, I was like, man, is this thing ever going to heal? Maybe I didn't make the right call. Maybe this is like, but you know, it's 8 months into it now and I'm still making gains. So I'm still healing. The pain's completely gone. So a lot of those things are, you know, the questions I had where I was like, did I make the right move on this thing? Mm-hmm. I certainly did. My like feels so good riding moto. It feels so good riding bikes now. Yeah. It just was, it was a little tough for a while.
At first.
Yeah.
Has it made knack-knacks easier?
I haven't tried a knack-knack with my new knee yet. I haven't. Yeah. I'll have to report back on that. I don't know.
Okay. Hey, we're going to take a quick break to hear from our sponsors. Back for more with Jeremy McGrath. Hey guys, welcome back to the Swap Moto Live Show presented by OGIO Powersports and FMF Racing, joined by Jeremy McGrath, who, so we were just talking about the pain of the knee surgery and all that. When you got to be able to start moving and stuff, was like cycling the best therapy for it?
Yeah, I mean, cycling's always the best therapy. Mm-hmm. Problem is, like, if you use clips, right?
The
twisting was fine, but if I was ever to fall because the range of motion wasn't, it hurt pretty bad for a long time, you know, as you're trying to get range of motion. So if I was ever to fall maybe on my left side, I could have probably, I don't know how much damage it would have caused. It's fixed, right? So there's nothing, I don't think I can hurt it, but it would have hurt me.
Yeah.
So, you know, I took it easy. I took it easy for a while.
Yeah. So how long were you off a motorcycle before you got back on? Because I think, wasn't that Bell photo shoot you guys did the first time you rode?
I did a photo shoot with Kawasaki for the posters at Mumford's place up there before Supercross, and I had surgery October 23rd.
That was like 2 months.
So 2 months, and I should not have been on a bike. So I rode and just kind of did a little of this, but it was hurting.
Yeah.
Like it was hurting, but I had to do posters. So, and then 10 weeks after I did, 10 weeks after we went on a ski trip, New Year's, and I skied with my knee brace and the whole thing, but I just went with my kids. Like, I shouldn't have been doing that either. It didn't, luckily I didn't fall and it didn't hurt me. There's no way I could have snowboarded at that point since I've snowboarded a lot more now. But I'm excited for the next winter, and my moto, like riding moto right now is great, and riding mountain bikes is awesome, so.
Did the repairs to your knee make moto easier or just less painful?
I'm not sure it made it like stability wise on my knee, I think is similar to the way it was. So it was, you know, that never bothered me. It's mm-hmm. loose, but it never bothered me. Having no pain is really been nice.
Yeah.
Yeah. So it's that part of it. The reason why I did it was because I was in so much pain. Mm-hmm. I have no pain now. Yeah. So that part's good.
That's good. So, another big thing you did this past summer was the King of the Hammers.
Yeah.
Is this the hammer?
Yeah, that's the car. Yeah. I just took the big tires off it, but we run those 35 Rockzilla Maxxis tires on there mm-hmm. that are just rock eaten. Just, they love the rock. So, but yeah, this is the car. I could do King of the Hammers with a hurt knee, right?
Because yeah.
I had a co-driver, and if I ever had to have problems and pull a cable or pull a winch to get over a rock or whatever, mm-hmm. Brendan was my co-driver, and he was always hustling the cable. So mm-hmm. I didn't really have to get out of the car for the whole 4 hours, and, you know, until the end when we ended up having a problem, and I had to walk up on the top of this hill and then call somebody to figure out what I was going to do on yeah. parts and all this stuff. So. Anyways, yeah, what a crazy event. Loved it. Yeah. I loved it. I can't wait for next year.
Okay, so the Kawasaki Teryx is pretty badass. I mean, like, I've only been in one UTV before, but, you know, I've been drooling over these things in here.
Yeah.
How much of your truck skill transfers into this? Is this, like, easy compared to racing a truck?
These things are not quite the speed as a race truck, you know? Mm-hmm. I would say this. My race truck's designed for short course track. It'd be more like a supercross truck.
Mm-hmm.
These things have a little more, you know, obviously it's a UTV. It's made for desert stuff, mm-hmm. big rocks. Suspension's quite a bit looser, softer, more agile when it comes mm-hmm. to that stuff. So it's a completely different type of feel. These things don't go nearly as fast as the race truck, so mm-hmm. stuff doesn't happen as fast.
Yeah.
You know, so you have a lot of time to think. But you know, I think combination of short course truck racing, supercross, motocross, all those skills kind of come into the set when you're mm-hmm. driving these things, especially when you're competing in an event like King of the Hammers.
Yeah.
Where line choices, you know, you could either pick the right line or you could fall off a 6-foot cliff or whatever and go upside down. So there's a lot of the same things that come into play.
Yeah. So that was that saying that you were saying a lot when a lot of the motocross guys are going short. Was it, with age comes a cage?
You know, I hear that saying a lot, with age comes a cage, but I like the cage, but I like my dirt bike the best
yeah.
still. I mean,
yeah.
like my favorite thing in the world is still to ride my dirt bike. So mm-hmm. Maybe with age, you can also get a cage, is the way I'll put it.
So, yeah.
I don't know.
The other thing you have going big is, you know, your development role with Maxxis Tires. They sponsor your, obviously, your four-wheel endeavors and stuff, but
yeah.
you helped develop the new Maxxis ST, which is an awesome tire. Any news on a HT or something for hard pack?
I know that we've developed the HT already, so mm-hmm. you know, COVID's kind of threw a wrench into everything.
Yeah.
And when people are releasing stuff, the MXST is out now, and it's an awesome tire, unbelievable. Mm-hmm. I mean, you know, you've ridden it. We've had a lot of guys riding it. Everyone's loving it. So, I mean, I'm having fun. Maxxis has really mm-hmm. created a great opportunity for me and four wheel for me and UTV, and of course the development of the moto stuff.
Mm-hmm.
So, it's been a great, you know, we're considered family now, I would say, and Maxxis partnership for me is just, it's at the top of my list. You know, these guys put their heart and soul into making great stuff, great mm-hmm. tires, and winning.
Yeah.
And we won the Pro 2 Championship in 17 and just crushed everyone. Then we come out last year, I raced two races with my truck with the Bighorn, on which we got to run production tires now.
Mm-hmm.
Came out with my truck at Glen Helen, went back-to-back wins. And then almost we got third at Crandon in the fall last year. So our stuff's, you know, Maxxis does a great job when it comes mm-hmm. to competition, but they also do a great job with all their stuff. And
yeah.
It's great to be part of that family.
Hey, when you came out of, you know, truck retirement or whatever and won those two races at Glen Helen, was it just kind of like, yeah, that's what's up, bitches?
Or well, like, I mean, you know, look, it's... we had been working on the truck. Vic Hill, my engine sponsor, like we had just built a new engine for it. They keep changing the rules. We had to put a spec engine now in the truck. We lightened it up again. Mm-hmm. So, you know, it's just, we just kept working and working, and you know, truck racing is all about like fine tuning your setup, and I think I was extremely proud of my team and my guys, and to come out and just dominate like that, mm-hmm. without being off a year.
Yeah.
It was pretty cool. No one could touch us.
Yeah.
Like the truck was so good. And you know, you're only as good as your weapon, right? I mean, but we did a good job on building the truck, and, mm-hmm. and it was great. So made life easier at the track.
Nice. And then you came back with new restrictions and rules and stuff, right? Like you were saying, they changed the engine.
Yeah, but I made the changes prior. So
you did.
It's all set up to what spec is now.
Yeah.
But that's what I mean. Like, it's funny, when I had my unlimited engine in there, mm-hmm. like I couldn't win back to back races. Like I'd win one time on a weekend, and then maybe, you know, top five or top three or whatever, mm-hmm. would be considered a good weekend. But once we changed the spec engine, and it was like, whoa, all of a sudden the truck was just on fire.
Yeah.
And nobody could keep up with us. So yeah, it's a good feeling. It's kind of like, you know, back in those days when I used to race dirt bikes. Mm-hmm.
What about the truck racing with your girls? Are they still pretty active in? I see the...
Yeah, I've been... You can see around here, I'm working on their carts. And,
yeah.
You know, they kind of race for fun. It's just a hobby. Mm-hmm. This last winter, when the COVID thing first hit, me and my wife and my girls started going to the desert. So we started taking the Teryxes out to the desert. My girls have never driven out in the desert with these things, and they absolutely fell in love with it.
Really? Yeah, isn't Rowan driving like the blue one or something?
Yeah, well, Rowan's driving, we had four Teryxes out there. And so she was driving a little bit of everything. We had that one, we had a couple more, but we had three or four Teryxes out there. And Bergen, who's 12 years old, she can barely see over the wheel. She did over 200 miles in one weekend driving these things. So I think what we're going to do now is, they are racing short course a little bit, and mm-hmm. we plan to do that. So I've been working on their cars, trying to prep them and learn some things about how to make them faster, because, you know, right now we have like 10th place cars.
Yeah.
And so we need to figure out how to tune the cars up better to get them up front. Mm-hmm. I know the girls can drive. They've been driving a lot. I got them street carts. They like putting a lot of time into it.
Yeah.
So dad's got to be a little better on the prep. So I'm working on that. But we're also, I think what we're going to do is, which would be another cool Maxxis project, is we're going to build a couple Teryxes, Rowan, me, and Bergen, and we're going to build three cars that we can go like desert worthy. So mm-hmm. I want to build them a race car so they can maybe race best in desert or something like that. Get them going on a little bit of that, and then create some social media around the kids and how they're joining in the off-road world and learning the UTVs and stuff. So, with the new KRX, it's like a perfect fit. So.
Yeah, when you're talking about building the three, I kept thinking of like the Goldilocks tail, like little mama bear, papa bear.
Yeah, dad's car.
Yeah.
Yeah. So all the stuff we're learning with the cars, we're just gonna make it so, you know, the kids each have their own. And so I'm looking forward to a fun summer and a fun next winter, because we're going to have some cool stuff going on.
Yeah. Do the kids know how cool their dad is, or are you just dad? Like, it's funny because, you know, my daughters are grown up now, right? And we'll talk about things I did with them when they were little and stuff, and stuff that they thought was so cool when they were little. Now they're like, oh, can't believe we did that or whatever.
Really?
Like the cool bus, right? You bought that school bus and you labeled the cool bus and lifted it and everything. Do you still drive them to school in that thing and pick up friends?
Well, Rowan is now going into ninth grade, so she's 14.
Yeah.
The cool bus is a little maybe not as cool to her.
Yeah.
Bergen's 12. She still likes it. She still wants to roll around with her friends in it.
Mm-hmm.
But I think the cool bus might be, the life of the cool bus for us might be coming to an end.
Yeah.
So someone else is going to have to do the same, you know, pick it up and do the same thing with their kids. I've offered to like get rid of the cool bus and maybe get like a cool Volkswagen bus, mm-hmm. that we could have a lot of bench seating in and cruise the beach and do stuff like that. They're still not 100% on letting me get rid of the cool bus.
Yeah.
So, you know, to say, do they think their dad's cool? I don't. I don't really know. I just let them try and experience all the fun stuff I'm doing. My life is fun.
Yeah.
You know, like I have a fun life. And to not share that with them would be a disservice to them.
Yeah.
You know, and they can decide later at their whatever they want, whether it was cool or not.
Mm-hmm.
But I know they love going to the desert. They love riding dirt bikes. They love riding, driving side by sides. They love racing their trucks. We also play, they play basketball. They play, play lacrosse. So we do school sports too. You know, and I know these days a lot of parents, you know, they really hone down and focus on whatever that one sport is that their kids really, you know, like the most, or maybe become the best at, or whatever. You know, we're just still trying to experience all of it. You know, I'm trying to get Rowan and Bergen are both going on mountain bike rides with me now. So they take the e-bike and I ride the regular bike.
Oh, nice.
And so, you know, I'm just trying to, I just hang with them as much as I can. I just love them so much. You know, it's just, we just have such a good time as a family. And as long as they want to keep playing with me, I'm going to keep playing with them. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
Keep doing stuff, keep doing sports, off-road, whatever it is. And just keep it fun, keep the smiles going.
I can. Hey, we're going to take another quick break, hear from our sponsors. We'll be back for one more segment with Jeremy.
Don't try to be the fastest on the track.
Be the fastest ever. Work harder than everyone else.
Because dedication is everything.
If they say your goals are crazy, be insane.
Be fast.
Be the crazy one.
Be unstoppable. One goal, one vision.
We put our heads together to both reimagine and lift the bar on what a modern motocross helmet should be. Opt for the highest level of modern technology and energy dispersion with the Fly Racing Formula helmet. Designed for an elevated defense against a wider range of real-world impact scenarios. Globally engineered with the most advanced materials and technologies available. Outfit yourself with proven technology, lightweight performance, and elevated impact management with the Fly Racing Formula helmet.
What's up, guys? It's Brock Tickle. I ride for the JGR Yoshimura Factory Suzuki Racing Team, and I'm stoked to be back at the races. Planning my comeback to racing was cool to see. I have a lot of support behind me to get me here. FXR stepped up and invested in me, and I'm stoked to be part of them. FXR honestly kind of blew me away. All the product is awesome. The pants fit me awesome. The best fitting pant I've ever worn, and everything's sublimated and it looks good.
To put our adventures on hold. But now is the perfect time to prepare for their return. Amsoil has your back with fast, free shipping, and ordering has never been easier. Just look up your vehicle, select your product, add an oil change to your cart, and check out. Spend $50 on Amsoil products and shipping is on us. Order now at amsoil.com.
Hey guys, welcome back to the Swap Moto Live Show presented by OGIO Powersports and FMF Racing. Joined by Jeremy McGrath here. Yeah, dude, so all the dad talk, like, I, and corny like that, right? I could talk about kids all day and everything, but what do you see for your girls? Like, obviously they're what, just starting high school and everything, but it goes quick, right?
Yeah, it's, dude, it's so weird to think that like in 4 years, Rowan's gonna be in college, yeah, going to college, you know, and then what, 6 years, Bergen will be in college. It's just weird. I think maybe at that point, that's when you liquidate everything, right? Because they're out of the house, you liquidate everything, and then you just get an apartment wherever their school is, and me and Kim can travel and hang with them a little bit, and we yeah, can just travel and do whatever. So Kim's always said that wherever the kids go to college, we'll end up having an apartment. So
yeah. Dude, 6 years from now is gonna be the gnarliest time in your life, because that's when both girls will be out at college. And dude, the empty nest shock is like nothing else I've ever experienced
really
in my life, dude. I only had it for like a few months though, because my oldest daughter, she graduated a semester early. And so I only had empty nest for one semester, but dude, it was like having to discover my relationship with my wife to do stuff with her without the kids, you know? But it was strange. And I think,
well, that's what they say, right? You kind of like, you got to get to know your wife kind of
yeah,
thing.
It was funny,
I think, luckily for us, Kim and I, we do a lot of stuff together.
Yeah. Anyway, but for me, like by the time Sammy graduated and moved home, it was like World Series of Love. Like we were going on dates every weekend and everything. It's like, oh, you're home?
Oh, I'm sure after a while it feels like, wait, you're invading our space again
yeah,
now. But I'm sure it's the greatest thing in the world when your kids come home from college.
Yeah,
like is. Come visit you or come to back live with you or whatever. It's a weird situation. I don't know how it's gonna be. I don't know. I know Rowan's motivated. You know, she's a pretty smart girl, so I'm not too worried about him.
Mm-hmm.
Bergen, she's good. She's a little more loose, a little more fly by the seat of her pants kind of kid, so we'll have to watch her, see how that develops. But you know, I guess for the most part, is one of the good things is we will be able to pay attention. You mm-hmm, know what I mean? It's not like we don't have the time to pay attention to what's
yeah,
going on.
Yeah.
And I know a lot of parents are busy, and sometimes that's not the case, but we're fortunate in that side of it.
Cool. All right, the other big thing you have going on in your life is Arma. Arma's it's enjoyed its first year.
Yeah, it's about 1 year old.
About 1 year old now. So I think it's crazy the way you guys took that brand, because in its previous existence, it was known for energy, and it's become a sports nutrition thing now. But the branding and the product and the image and everything has been excellent, right? You guys have successfully launched this sports supplements brand, and it has to be exciting for you, because it's like, there's so many names associated with it. It's like you, Nick Way, Chad Reed, and now Adam Cincirillo.
Yeah.
It's been going great, right?
Yeah, I think, Arma's been doing really, really well. And you know, it's been documented what Arma was before.
Mm-hmm.
Scott's one of my partners and Cause, and there's a few guys in there. And of course, it's great having guys like Chad and Adam and Nick, you know, three heavy hitters when it comes to the moto world,
mm-hmm,
and myself. So, when we talked about the idea of bringing Arma out as a supplement company, you know, for me, it's about the importance is about the product.
Mm-hmm.
You know, and if you build a product that it speaks for itself, then you're gonna, you know, you can get some legs. Business is not easy. Anyone who started a business is not. They know it's not easy. We're a direct-to-consumer business at this point. Supplement business is a very big world out there.
Mm-hmm.
We're trying to, you know, get some footing and make some headway. We think we're doing a good job. But most importantly, we have great product. And anyone who's tried Arma can vouch for that.
Mm-hmm.
So we're happy. We got great partners. We just keep plugging away. You know, it's a big world out there. It's trying mm-hmm, to get some traction but we're making it. We're doing it. Just gotta keep plugging away and figure out how to keep doing it. So,
yeah.
But we're in it for the long haul. Got some good partners, yeah, good team, and yeah, we're going for it. It's been great.
Yeah. How involved have you been in the development of stuff? Like, are you just testing things, or do you throw on a white lab coat and go to the factories or the...
Well, we use a place called Simpson Labs in Valencia, and so I have been there a couple times. Mm-hmm. I'm not sure, they didn't need me to put on a lab yet, but a lab coat yet. But I have checked the facility out. I've done a lot of testing. Scott and I do it a lot. I do a lot of the physical side of it, right? Because mm-hmm. I'm riding mountain bikes all the time and road bikes. So figure out how to, you know, some stuff. We're trying stuff all the time. Mm-hmm. You know, we want to just have mastered what we actually make, which is the Blitz and our pre-workout, which is the Fire, and then we got the our protein, which is Reload. So, you know, our three products right now are pretty awesome. We just continue to test and try to figure out what the next product is to develop. Mm-hmm. We have single serves, we have tubs, we have all that. So, yeah, I mean, don't want to spread ourselves too thin.
Yeah.
In the beginning, you know, we know we've been around for a year. We've gained a lot of traction. Just kind of keep our head down and mm-hmm. keep supplying the customer with what they want. And anyone who hasn't tried it should be trying it, because for physical activities, hands down, there's nothing out there like Blitz.
Dude, Blitz is amazing. And the cool thing, it's evolved since you guys launched as a brand, right? It's its second formulation right now.
Yeah.
And at one point I was talking to AC and he's all, do you have the new Blitz yet? And I'm all, yeah, I have the new Blitz, because I had just gotten one.
Mm-hmm.
And then after I ran out, I really did get the new one. It tastes so much better. It's more stable as well.
More stable. That was one of the things. And we had some ingredients in the other one that would just cause a little bit of, just clumping and some stuff.
Yeah, clumping more, sure.
Maybe if you kept it on the shelf or in a warm place. Our new formula is just, and I mean, it's incredible tasting,
mm-hmm.
and it's got more beneficiary products in it. It's just like, as far as workout stuff goes, amazing.
Yeah. You know what you guys need to do for your next rendition of it is do your taste testing warm, right? Because here's like, so I like put,
because you're in a water bottle on a bike.
I put the Blitz in a bottle with ice cubes, but it's been so hot lately, right? I'm like going like drinking warm Blitz. I'm like, ooh, you know, like if you made a flavor that tastes just as good warm as cold.
Well, I think the trick to it when your bottle's going to warm up, right? So I think you want to lean it out a little. Need to lean it a little.
Okay.
Because if it's tasting strong, or when it's warm, when you're on your hour mm-hmm. or two mountain bike ride or whatever, it doesn't, if you lean it out and it's not as strong, the warmth doesn't bother you.
Okay. All right. So mountain bikes, what is your take on the whole e-bike movement, right? Because like I was in Salt Lake for 3 weeks, right? And like I took both. I took Stumpy and Olivo. All the guys I rode with wanted to ride e-bikes all the time up there. And so I was like, all right. Like, I missed my Stumpy for sure and took it out on some rides alone, but.
How'd that go?
So the first few times I rode, because it was altitude, right?
Right.
I rode the Levo, and I was like, oh, this is fun. And I was like, yeah, I'm still breathing pretty hard. And the first day I took the Stumpy out, I went.
You're dying?
And, dude, I almost pretended I had a flat tire. It was so hard, you know, but.
My take on the e-bike world is, I've never seen so many smiles on bike rides that you see when you're riding e-bikes.
Yeah.
And if everyone's riding e-bikes, it's awesome.
Yeah.
You know, I have the new SL, right?
New SL, yeah.
Yeah. And it's amazing too. It's kind of the in-betweener between the pedal and the regular Levo, right? And I'm enjoying that too, because the thing someone might worry about is that if they ride their e-bike too much, they're going to get out of shape from riding their regular bike.
Mm-hmm.
And just like you said, you know, it's quite a bit more work when you go from your Levo to your regular bike.
Yeah.
So, you know, it's really, I have guys that just don't even want to ride their regular bikes anymore. They just want to ride e-bikes only.
Yeah.
But I can see why. It's so fun.
Mm-hmm.
But I'm still like, I still am glutton for punishment a little bit, you know? So like there's days when I know I need to go out and I need to work and I need to grind and just hurt myself.
Yeah.
And you can't do that on, you know, you can't do that on an e-bike.
You can do it on an e-bike if you turned it way down.
I never ride mine on anything but low.
Really?
But I don't think.
See, when I ride the TE bike, I'm like, dude, if I have turbo, I'm on turbo.
Yeah, I only ride mine on low.
Yeah.
So I don't know. I love them. So yeah. I guess my opinion is I love them.
Yeah.
Good. Like I think people that hate on them just never rode them. So yeah. Whatever.
Yeah. Right on.
But I like my regular bike too.
Yeah.
Like I ride my 29 Stump Jumper all the time. That's what I ride. And then if my friends call and they're like, hey, let's go ride bikes. Let's ride e-bikes. I'm like, okay.
Yeah.
I'll do that too.
You know who loves e-bikes? RV.
Yeah.
Dude, I'm sure that's all he wants to ride.
I'm sure he does.
I think he has a Coors Light in his bottle.
Yeah.
But,
that's funny.
Hey, so, man, thanks for joining me again. It's always fun to catch up with you. And, Whistler 2021. We'll do another.
It's back on the books.
We'll do another tequila podcast.
We are for sure going to do another tequila podcast. Yeah. I'm in for that too.
Awesome.
Yeah. Right. Thanks for having me. See you later.
Yeah. Thanks for watching, guys. We'll see you next week.